Good evening, everybody. I would like to welcome you to Quinnipiac University. My name is Bill Schweizer. I'll be your host this evening. Looking out, I mean, the faces out there, it's just great. This whole atmosphere of a Final Four, a Frozen Four in a team sport. And I'm sure you're all kind of really soaking in the atmosphere here, but don't let anything go by. Get the most out of everything that you see, hear, and participate in this weekend, because you never know if it'll ever come your way again. You're really a special group, and make sure you take advantage of it all. I had the pleasure of broadcasting a couple of Final Fours for teams, one in men's basketball, and before all of you players were born, Villanova beat Georgetown in the 1985 NCAA championship game. And then last year I got to do a men's hockey Frozen Four in Pittsburgh. I broadcast the Quinnipiac games. And it didn't end the way Quinnipiac had hoped it would end, but just the whole atmosphere of being there, being in a Frozen Four, it really is a special time. And we hope your stay here in Hamden and your stay at Quinnipiac is a good experience for everybody. I would like to bring up the Executive Vice President and Provost of Quinnipiac University, Mark Thompson, for a few words. Mark?
Well, good evening, everyone, and welcome to Quinnipiac University. Welcome the teams and the NCAA staff to the 2014 Women's Frozen Four. We're very excited, honored to host this event at Quinnipiac University's TD Bank Sports Center. And congratulations to the teams. First up, two-time defending champion Minnesota. First time at Quinnipiac, from what I understand, and their 10th appearance in the Frozen Four. Clarkson, it's always good to have you here at Quinnipiac. See you represent the ECAC hockey in their first advancement to the Frozen Four. Making their 7th appearance at the Frozen Four is Wisconsin on Friday. As you know, it will be your 5th time you'll face Minnesota this year. And for the second straight year advancing to the Frozen Four, Mercyhurst, making their 4th appearance in 6 years. I want to acknowledge the hard work and dedication of each student athlete, every coach, and the many staff members who have given so much in order to get their team to this point. It's not been easy. Each of you has earned your place in this room tonight. I also want to thank a couple of our Quinnipiac exemplars. We had a tremendous amount of effort going into this event to make sure that it went off smoothly and it was a good experience for all of you. A lot of our staff who spent a lot of time preparing for this event are sitting over to my left, so I thank them for what they've done. But in particular, I do want to thank our Frozen Four co-directors, two gentlemen who constantly give 110% to everything that they do, and to take on this additional effort to make sure that this was a great event for us. I just think they did a truly tremendous job. Eric Gergrich and Jamie Sokowski. Could you stand, Eric and Jamie, so we can thank you? In addition, I want to thank our Director of Athletics and Recreation, Jack McDonald, and the entire athletics department who've worked tirelessly in preparation for this weekend. And I also want to thank the town of Hamden for their support and collaboration in helping us host this event, given its size and prestige. And what did you think about your state police escorts this afternoon? That was pretty neat, huh? So we thank them too. Next few days are sure to be exciting, and I sincerely wish all involved a great experience. Anything we can do to make your experience better, please just make sure you ask us. We'd be happy to accommodate you in any way to make sure your needs are fulfilled. Best wishes to all of you, and I hope that you enjoy your next couple days here.
Thank you, Mark. I know everybody's anxious to eat. One more speaker, and then we're going to get to the good part of the evening, get to the food. But I would like to introduce a very important person, the NCAA Women's Ice Hockey Committee Chair, Meg Morrison. Meg?
I promise I will be brief, since dinner is the next thing up on the menu here. Good evening. On behalf of the NCAA committee and the NCAA staff, it's my honor to welcome you all to the opening event of the 2014 NCAA Women's Frozen Four. First, as our speakers did before me, I want to thank the Quinnipiac staff, Jack McDonald, the local organizing committee, for this fabulous event and for all the hard work and preparation that went into everything that's going to go on this weekend. So let's thank them. It's a thrill to get to the 2014 Women's Frozen Four underway and to be here with all of you tonight, the best teams in women's college hockey. Congratulations to all of you on making the championship. Your dedication, effort, and teamwork have come together to get you this far. I wish you the best of luck in the rest of the tournament, and I hope each and every one of you takes some time to enjoy your Frozen Four experience. Thank you.
Thank you, Megan. Guy. Up our guest speaker, and she is very familiar with the position that you folks are in right now. She had a wonderful hockey career at college at Harvard, even though she ditched Yale to go to Harvard, a New Haven resident. Great international career as well, bronze medalist in the 2006 Winter Olympic Games, silver medalist in the 2010 Winter Olympic Games, four-time member of the U.S. Women's National Team, our guest speaker, Caitlin Cahow.
Short kid. Thank you so much. It's an honor to be here with you guys. You know, this, as an athlete, as a competitor, this is the type of room that I love to be in because you can just feel it. You can feel the energy. You know, it's like you're in the eye of the hurricane here. And I just love being able to look out and seeing, knowing that there are going to be some amazing things done from people in this room tomorrow and the days ahead. So congrats for making it this far. I have I have to admit something to you, and it's pretty shameless. I follow Britt Ammerman on Twitter, which some others may. And the reason I bring it up is because she tweeted out a picture last night that really struck me, and it was a picture of the ice out there, like 50 yards that way. And it's clean, ready to go. And it just brought me back. Like, it brought me back to sitting in this room. It brought me back to the banquet the night before the big games. And I just got lost in it. And I think for me, it's because once you're a hockey player at this level, that never really leaves you. You remember the smell of the ice. You remember the feel of the rink. You remember seeing that clean sheet of ice and knowing that it's just pure opportunity out there. And, you know, in my career, I've been lucky. I've played on some big games, stepped out on the clean sheets of ice just like that. And the one thing that I remember from all those experiences is that, you know, there are kind of two sides to that coin when you step out onto the clean sheet, two sides to that opportunity. And the way to be successful is you have to be able to take with you the things from your past that are going to help you, that are going to move you forward, but you also have to be able to leave behind the stuff that's going to hold you back. And every single person in this room I know has the ability to do that, or otherwise you wouldn't be here. You know, you've had that experience in games where you step out onto the ice and you go out for your shift and you make a mistake and you head back to the bench dragging your head thinking, oh man, I really screwed that up. My teammates are going to be mad. My coach is going to be mad. I'm not going to go out next shift. What do? You sit down. You have about 60 seconds to do something with that emotion. And the only way that you're going to go out and have a better shift than the one before is if you are able to get rid of that negativity and at the same time take the lessons that you learned from that mistake and bring them with you. But more than that, you guys are also accomplished. You realize that it's more than just the last shift. It's the last 18 years of your life or more, depending on what year you are. It's the support that you have from your teammates and your friends and your families and your communities, the hours you spent on the ice or in the weight room, you know, the times that you've spent alone in rinks just with the sound of your own blades keeping you company. You have that with you every single time you go back on the ice. And so you sit there for 60 seconds and you regroup and then you go out and you do something amazing. That's the blank sheet that we love. That's the blank sheet that we want as hockey players. And the great thing is that those lessons that you learn each time you step out on that blank sheet and do something amazing, those lessons are going to make you awesome at whatever you do. And that may seem hard. You may not be able to think past hockey right now, and you shouldn't have to because you need to be in this moment. But for me, I know I retired from hockey last year, and it was scary. I didn't know what I was going to do. I had some ideas, but when you leave the game that you love and you leave something that you're really good at, you take a risk. You take a risk that you're going to have to learn something new or you're going to have a new experience that you know nothing about yet. And that really can be scary. As soon as I left hockey, I had a lot of different challenges, a lot of different opportunities, and I didn't really know which direction I should be going. And then this past year, most recently, my president asked me to serve on his delegation to the Olympic Games in Sochi. Never saw that coming. That was a whole new kind of challenge for me. And, you know, I had to take a look at that opportunity, that blank sheet, and say, okay, what am I going to do? I'm going to take the things from my past that I know will make me better, that I know will make me successful in this new situation, and I'm going to leave behind my fears. I'm going to leave behind my concerns because I can do this. I have that confidence. And I was able to do it. And one of the major reasons that I was able to do it was because I can always think back on my hockey experience in college, sitting right where you guys are right now. That's what gives me confidence every single day to challenge myself and to become better. And I always think back to my freshman year at Harvard. You know, I may be kind of unique in this room. You guys are all incredibly talented, and you've had really great careers, but I didn't come from a hockey family. I'm the only person in my family who plays hockey, and I'm probably the only person in this room whose mother taught them to skate. If I'm wrong, you can correct me later. But, you know, my dad was from the rural South, and he didn't see snow till he went to college. So the first and only time he ever skated or attempted to skate, he didn't know you had to take your skate guards off. So it ended pretty quickly. That was my introduction to hockey. That didn't matter, though. I liked the game enough, and I was a good athlete. So by the time I got to Harvard, I had been a four-sport athlete in college, and I thought, I'm just going to come in here and blow the barn doors off this thing. I'm going to be awesome. I'm going to be in the first line. Everyone's going to love me. I'm going to score a million goals, blah, blah, blah. I'm going to win a national championship. Then about halfway through my freshman year, I found myself as the fourth person rotating on the third line of the Harvard University Crimson. That was me. And that was very different. That meant something quite different 10 years ago than it does now. Because if you were the fourth person rotating on the third line at Harvard, you probably weren't going to see the ice on any given day. And that's all right, though. You know, I thought, all right, this is an adjustment. Sooner or later, coach is going to see how awesome I am. She's going to put me in. I'm going to be on the first line. I'm going to be scoring all the goals. Well, I would look forward to weekends when I thought we might play a team that wasn't as strong as we were. I thought I might get some ice time. And one of those weekends finally rolled around, looking for it, had it circled on my schedule a month in advance, walked down that hallway to go to the locker room, glanced at the dress list just casually, wasn't on it. Didn't get a jersey that weekend. Sat in the stands, devastated, didn't know what to do. Called my mother, cried. I had two options. I could either give up, give in, I guess those are the same thing, go along with the status quo, or I could do something about it. So I took a chance. There was an opportunity to go and train with one of my college teammates out in Minnesota that next summer. I'd never been to Minnesota. I wasn't not sure I could have picked it out on a map. And I didn't know anyone there. I told my mother I was going to go to summer school at the University of Minnesota and babysit to pay my living expenses. So she said, okay. I didn't really know who to approach about playing hockey or getting better. I just knew that there might be the opportunity there to skate and improve. So I thumbed through the white pages when those still existed, and I found the name of Jenny Potter, who I recognized. I knew that she had a training program in the summer for college players. Called her up and said, excuse me, Mrs. Potter. Do you think I could come and train with you this summer? And she said, I guess so. That's how I met Jenny Potter. And every day for the next 2.5 months, we trained together side by side without speaking. Talk about being intimidated. One of the best hockey players in the world is beating me in everything, every single day, nonstop for hours on end and not speaking. That was a whole different type of character development. But at the end of the day, I went back to Harvard with the confidence that I had learned a lot more, the confidence that I had developed, brought that with me, and I let go of the fear of failure, the fear that I wouldn't be good enough, and just trusted that when the opportunity arose, I would make something of it. That end of that season, I got invited to try out for the U.S. Olympic team. And the next year, I went to my first Olympic Games in Torino, Italy, about a year after I had been the fourth person rotating on the third line at Harvard. I tell you the story not to pump my own tires. That's not what it's about. It's about recognizing that every single person in this room, we're all alike. We're all hungry. We're all competitors. We're all great athletes. We're all highly motivated, talented individuals. We balance a million things at once. We're students. We're athletes. We're sisters. We're daughters. We're, you know, pretty much everything under the sun. And that's good. We can balance that stuff. That's got to give us confidence. The confidence to know that when the opportunity arises, when there's a blank sheet in front of you, take that with you. Don't worry about the rest. It's going to fall into place. And especially for this weekend, there's a pretty nice looking blank sheet about 50 yards that way that's ready to be written on. The coolest part about all of this is that none of you, not anyone in this room, has played the best hockey that they can play yet this season. Because you all know that you only play your best when you play against the best. We got the best hockey players in the country in this room. That makes me pretty excited. I'd be pretty fired up to play knowing that the best was still to come. So my advice to you would be, get a good night's sleep, get a good breakfast, and go out there knowing that that blank sheet's waiting for you to write on it. And it's totally up to you, 100%. Best of luck to all of you. Have an unbelievable time. Enjoy yourselves. Take it all in. Just live in the moment. Good luck.
Thank you, Caitlin. Thank you, Caitlin. Next, if Meg Morrison could come up, we have a presentation we're going to make. It is the presentation of the Elite 89 Award. Now, it's the fifth year that this award has been around. It was instituted to recognize the true essence of the student athlete by honoring the individual who has reached the pinnacle of competition, the national championship level, at his or her sport, while also achieving the highest academic standard among his or her peers. The Elite 89 is presented to the student athlete with the highest cumulative grade point average, participating in the final site for each of the NCAA's 89 championships. The recipient of the Elite 89 for the National Collegiate Women's Ice Hockey Championship with a 3.944 in business administration, Vanessa Gagnon, Clarkson University. Congratulations. And now there is a championship video that we are going to see up on the board, so focus your attention on that. First time I came in here and saw these screens, I asked if I could bring one of these home. Didn't happen. We have a video?